Hello, everyone. My name is Zhen Peng, and I'm a postdoc from David Baum's lab at the Wisconsin Institute for Discovery. Today, I'm going to share our recent topological analysis of real abiotic and biotic chemical reaction networks, which find that features shared by both networks help explain how chemical disequilibria can cause gradual complexification through the stepwise activation of autocatalytic systems. We all know that life is a complicated phenomenon. It has high diversity. It is organized in specific hierarchies. It has delicate regulatory mechanisms, and it can evolve over time. But all of these seem absent from the relatively simple abiotic environment, which includes materials like air, water, and minerals, and energy sources that are solar, geothermal, and even radioactive. How is the abiotic existence converted to life? Well, there are two options, biogenesis and abiogenesis. Biogenesis is a process where life assembles the abiotic materials and energies to new life that is similar to itself. And this is what modern biology mostly studies. In contrast, abiogenesis, by definition, should be a process starting from simple abiotic food and ending with a complex enough system that can be labeled life, while none of the intermediate steps involves life. Therefore, this process needs to explain how a non-life system could propagate, complexify, and evolve to generate lifelike systems. Even though the intermediate steps are not observable for now, the mechanism that governs these steps is likely to act for both the abiotic and biotic worlds today. Therefore, if we can find such a candidate mechanism, it should help us investigate abiogenesis. The candidate mechanism we propose is the C-dependent autocatalytic system, STAS. It is inspired by the biogenesis process. Modern life is essentially a seed that can convert food to more of itself, which is obviously an autocatalytic process depending on the presence of a seed. Is it possible that some molecules, which cannot be spontaneously synthesized from environmental food, can also act as a seed and induce a STAS? If so, we may infer that the STAS-based mechanism was important during the origins of life and may help us depict a roadmap for experimental studies on abiogenesis. There were three major parts in this study. First, we selected representative databases of abiotic and biotic reaction networks. Second, we developed an algorithm to find STASes from the networks. Third, we explain how the STAS-based mechanism could underlie the accumulation of complexity. The abiotic reaction database was based on a foremost reaction and a recently published collection of abiotic reactions, such as free radical reactions. The biotic reaction database was from a curated set of biochemical reactions that putatively represent the metabolism of the last universal common ancestor. For both reaction networks, we picked simple abiotic chemical species and energy sources as the food. Note that our choices do not mean that these reactions and species were indeed what existed prebiotically, but the general features and mechanisms shared by both networks may still be applicable to abiogenesis. For detecting a STAS, we will first introduce the operation of network expansion. Suppose that we have a reaction where two C1s and one C2 react to generate one C3 and one C4. And we can use a table to represent the stoichiometry of this reaction. The reactants have negative entries, while the products have positive ones. For a network with multiple reactions, we can write them in a stoichiometric matrix. Note that this graph only represents a subset of a bigger network for illustrative purpose. Then, with this matrix, we want to choose some species as food and some others as a seed, such that the seed cannot be spontaneously synthesized from food, but can trigger a STAS that produces the seed by consuming food. To illustrate how to achieve the goal, let us assume that we only provide C1 and C2 as the ultimate food. Then R1 can occur and produce C3 and C4, and then R2 can occur to produce C5. But now we cannot activate further reactions. We may call the existing species now as the food. Then we want to find a seed. Let us pick C6 as the candidate seed and add it to the system. Then further reactions can be activated. Then we continue expanding the network until we cannot expand anymore. Now, we can visually pick out a stats, where C3 and C5 are converted to more C6, C7, and C8. But how could we link the network topology to the matrix properties, which is necessary for dealing with large data? Well, we can parse the matrix to 4 segments. We have tier 0 spontaneous reactions and tier 1 reactions induced by the candidate seed. And we have external food involved in the tier 0 reactions and internal species induced by the candidate seed. To tell if a candidate seed can trigger a stats, we focus on the lower right segment. We can use linear programming to check whether a linear combination of the induced reactions can form a net reaction where all internal species are converted from external food. If such a combination exists, we know that the candidate seed can trigger a stats. For the abiotic database, we found a stats that can be induced by nitrogen dioxide or formaldehyde and ammonia together. For the biotic database, we found a stats that can be induced by lactic acid. These results confirm that stasis exist in both types of reactions. For now, our choices of food and seeds are somehow arbitrary. In the real prebiotic world, where could the prebiotic food and seeds come from? Well, for a local environment, any chemical species or energies that were relatively steadily supplied could be the food. And they were likely to be simple yet abundant. The possible seeds, in contrast, could be the products of locally rare reactions or sporadically imported from elsewhere. They don't have to be abundant because to trigger a stats, a small quantity of seeds were enough. And they could also be more complex than the food. Next, we examine how stasis could result in complexification. We know that tier 1 stats can feed on tier 0 food. So, it is natural to guess whether there exist some tier 2 stasis which consume the tier 0 and tier 1 chemicals as food, resulting in a hierarchical structure. By treating the tier 0 and tier 1 chemicals as external food, we can detect tier 2 stasis. For the abiotic reaction database, we found the tier 2 stats converting formaldehyde to monosaccharides. And for the biotic reaction database, we found the tier 2 stats synthesizing pyrimidines. These results suggest that stepwise activation of new stasis can make the reaction network complexify over time and help the system somehow remember what happened in the past within its network topology. Can we have even higher tiers of stasis? Well, for the abiotic reaction database, we were unable to find any. This could be because the network was too small or because the food and seeds we picked did not allow a tier 3 stats. But for the biotic reactions, we found that if we add one reaction, this RO6974, which is mechanistically similar to a reaction that is already in the database, we could get a tier 3 stats. More importantly, this tier 3 stats converts lower tier chemicals to purines and their derivatives, such as ATP, FAD, NAD, and coenzyme A, which are important cofactors in metabolism. These new higher tier chemicals not only increase the complexity of the reaction system, but also bring about beneficial effects to the entire system. For example, ATP and FAD may catalyze the phosphorylation of acetate, promoting the system's ability to assimilate phosphorus element. And the presence of NAD and NADP creates a new carbon fixation pathway which uses hydrogen sulfide as the terminal hydrogen donor, potentially increasing the efficiency of carbon fixation and the level of irreversibility of the reaction network. What's more, the presence of these cofactors helps the synthesis of long-chain amphiphiles, and amphiphiles may provide a compartmentalization mechanism, spatially organizing the reaction network and making the entire system more resistant to environmental perturbation. Thus, the stats-based mechanism can result in a system where lower-tier stasis provide food for higher-tier stasis, and higher-tier stasis provide benefits for the entire system by means such as catalysis. In fact, if we summarize the network organized by stasis and the metabolism of a living cell, we could see that their topological structures are very similar. In a living cell, the small molecule metabolisms are at the lower tiers, while the synthesis and replication of nucleic acids and proteins provide higher-tier chemicals catalyzing the entire network. This is not that surprising because the biotic database we used was based on cellular metabolism. But we should note that the stress-organized network can rely on small catalytic molecules rather than large and specialized enzymes. This suggests that a stress-based regulated metabolic network without complicated biomacromolecules catalyzing the reactions was possible during abiogenesis. With that, we can conclude that a stress-based mechanism works for both abiotic and biotic reaction networks, and it can cause the gradual complexification of a reaction network. Complexification may in return provide benefit for the entire system and could make it more adapt to the environment, bringing about more lifelike features, even without typical genetic and catalytic polymers. Nevertheless, this study has several weaknesses. First, the databases only cover a small proportion of known reactions. Second, most of the biotic reactions are enzymatic, meaning that they might be very slow or impossible under prebiotic conditions. Third, the spatial and temporal factors, which could shape the rates of reactions, are not yet considered. Therefore, to use this theoretical framework to help experimental studies, we will need to incorporate more reaction databases, thermodynamics, kinetics, and spatial and temporal contexts to better assess what could be the appropriate food set, seed set, and reaction conditions. With this, I would like to thank all members of the BOM Lab and our friends and collaborators. I would also like to thank NASA, NSF, and UW Medicine to support our series of research on the origins of life. And finally, thank you for watching this video.